So how do you query this database?
So I would optimize the queries using an SQL optimizer.
Let's say we have a lot of data, so optimizing queries is so, you know, old school.
So I could make an index on the table.
All right, indexing is cute, but we are looking for something which is serious, right? We got lots of data.
So can we use a NoSQL?
No, we are not going to learn RDBMS. Now, for the final time, what do you think we should do? So sharding, I'll use sharding.
Okay. Hired.
What is sharding? Let's say you have pizza and you can't have the entire thing by yourself. So you break it into slices and call your friends over. 8 friends. Now, each of these friends is going to get 1 slice of pizza. What you have done effectively is partitioned the pizza according to each friend's share. Just like that, we can have servers which are going to be taking the load of the requests which are being sent into it. So if there's a server here, now how do you get that to the pizza model?
User ID number 0 is going to start here, 100 starts here, 200.
What you have effectively done is taken all the server requests that you had and mapped them onto a pizza, such that each of these slices is going to be served by 1 server. In this case, server ID number 6. The key thing to notice here is we couldn't eat the entire pizza by ourselves. We needed friends to finish the pizza, to handle the pizza effectively. And when you're getting friends along, you're effectively taking the range of the pizza and breaking it into pieces. When you're doing that, you're partitioning the pizza. This kind of partitioning, which uses some sort of a key to break the data into pieces and allocate that to different servers, is called horizontal partitioning. Horizontal partitioning depends on 1 key, which is an attribute of the data that you're storing, to partition data. You can contrast this with vertical partitioning. There's a link in the description below, which uses columns to partition data effectively. But we are focusing on the horizontal partitioning bit, and specifically, we are focusing on 1 concept, which is sharding. Now, we mentioned that sharding is taking 1 attribute in the data and partitioning the data such that each server gets 1 chunk. But what do I mean by servers? The servers here are database servers. Again, contrast this with what we have been talking till now about normal servers. Normal servers are application servers, they're platform servers which deal with data, but they try to be as stateless as possible to keep things decoupled and really nice and clean. This is going to be dealing with the meat of the data. All right, and we can't afford to have any goof ups over here. Consistency is important. This is one of the key attributes of any database, that whatever data you persist in it is what you can read out of it later on. And there is some sort of synchronization that if a person makes an update, the new request is going to read that update. Okay, so that is consistency. Also, what we look at is availability, meaning that the database should not crash and stay down. You don't want that. You want your application to be running all the time. But consistency trumps availability when it comes to data, in most cases. There are more things to think about. What should you shard your data on? In our case, we have used user ID. But in applications like Tinder, which use location, you could shard on the location. And then if a person says, find me all the users in city X, then X may fall in this shard. And all you need to do is just read through this shard, which is what this database server number 7 can do for you, right? That shard is going to be smaller in size. It's also going to be easier to maintain, probably going to give you faster performance, everything good about sharding. And the first problem that you have to take into consideration is joins across shard. If these are across shards, what's going to happen is the query needs to go to 2 different shards. They need to pull out their data, then join the data across the network. And this is going to be extremely expensive. So one of the problems here are joins. The second point comes when you look at the pizza and you realize that this is completely inflexible. The shards are inflexible. You can't have more pizza slices or less pizza slices. It's already done. But we want our database servers to be flexible in number. So one of the really good algorithms for this is consistent hashing. You should have a look at that. There's one database which actually uses this, and that is memcached. Right? This doesn't really implement consistent hashing. You can use an application logic above the database memcached to get your work done. So it's not really a problem. It might be a problem, but you can't have dynamic number of shards. Now to overcome this problem, what we do is take a shard which has too much data in it, and then dynamically break it into pieces. So this pizza slice is like a pizza for us. Yeah, when we magnify it enough, it's going to be a really large slice, and then we break it into smaller pieces. So there's going to be some sort of a manager for every particular shard, which is going to map the requests to the correct mini slice, so to speak, in the pizza slice, single pizza slice. Using this technique, which is hierarchical sharding, we can get rid of the inflexibility over here. So point number two is no longer a big problem. Now, one of the smart things to do here is to create an index on these shards, assuming your query requires that. This index could be on a completely different attribute compared to the user ID. And one of the good examples of this is find me all the people in New York who have age greater than 50. So if these are the city IDs, then New York is going to land, let's say, here. And then you can index on age. So you'll find all users in New York within a given range of age. So all of your queries are fast. That's the most important thing about sharding. Your read performance goes up and your write performance goes up because all of your queries fall on one particular point. But what happens if a shard fails? Let's say there's some sort of electricity issue over there. In that case, you could have something like a master-slave architecture. The master-slave architecture is a very common architecture. What happens in this is that you have multiple slaves which are copying the master. Whenever there's a write request, it's always on the master. The master is the most updated copy, while the slaves continuously poll the master and read from it. What then happens is if there's a read request, it can be distributed across the slaves, while if there's a write request, it always goes to the master. In case the master fails, the slaves choose one master amongst themselves, right? And so there's good single point of failure tolerance over here. Conceptually, it's quite easy. You just take your data, break it into pieces, break it into ranges essentially, and then persist it in different places. But when it comes to practical application, this is quite tough because consistency is difficult to do. And if you're just starting out with your system and you're thinking about sharding, I suggest that you take into consideration other mechanisms like indexing, like using NoSQL databases, which internally actually use these kind of concepts. But to use those ready-made solutions or to use well-known solutions like indexing is probably the way to go before you go for sharding a database. Even more difficult than sharding is to hit the like and the subscribe button at the same time. If you're able to do that, then you'll get notifications for further videos, and I'll catch you next time.